Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Mayo Business Plan Competition. I am Catherine Jervis, the Dean of the School of Business here. We are so happy to see everybody in the audience in person, no masks. This is terrific. And it's going to be a great afternoon for you all. For all the people on Zoom, welcome. We're happy that you're here too with us. I wanted to mention to you that this is the 10th anniversary of the Mayo Business Plan, so it's a really exciting night. The whole purpose of this is to give students experience with developing a viable business product, service, and a plan that goes with it. And so it's a very significant academic exercise. You know that there are $60,000 in prizes that will be awarded here, $30,000 for the first place team, $20,000 for the second, and $10,000 for the third. We want to make a special thanks to Dr. Buddy Mayo, who is our benefactor for this program. He is here. And for Mr. Eric Szabo, who has also been a contributor to the Mayo Business Plan Competition. I also want to thank the first round judges. And so this actually starts in September at the end of the month. And then the first round judges, and I know several of you are either here in the audience or on Zoom, look through all the business plans initially and whittle it down to the six semifinals at teams. And then those teams present to our panel of judges who are here. So I would like to introduce, maybe they can just look at you and wave when I call their name. Gloria Weisbart is a Senior Vice President and Treasury Management Sales Consultant with Wells Fargo Treasury Management and Payment Solutions Group. So she's here on the end. Blair Worrell is currently an independent advisor to financial services companies. He had a very long career with Moody's Corporation, serving as the senior VP of rating operations. Ariana DeLucia is the current chief financial officer of AR James Media, an award-winning outdoor advertising company. And then Ryan Chu is a senior associate with Silicon Valley Bank's global funding practice. He is a 2018 Mayo Business Plan Competition winner. Marco was the name of his company. And so we're very excited to have these people here as a judge. So we should give them a round of applause. They have done a huge amount of work. So the way that this will go is each team will have 30 minutes to present, and the judges may interrupt them to ask questions in this particular round. We want to introduce our assistant dean, who's down here in the front, Tammy Dietrich, and for the teams, she will be your timekeeper. So please keep your eye on her, as she will indicate to you 5 minutes before your time is up, and then she will call it when you are completely through. Let's see if there, oh, I just want to mention two support people that have really been very beneficial for us. Nicole Began, our communications specialist, and you have seen Stephanie Horner running around the place setting up everything with Nicole. So thanks, oh, she's up here. So thanks to both of them too for all of their work. Otherwise, this wouldn't really happen. And so anyway, to introduce the first team, AlpineAid, these four gentlemen will introduce themselves, and we welcome them up to the podium or the stage.
All right, good evening and welcome everyone. Thank you all for being here. We're excited to present our product and company, the AlpineAid, which is the mountain simulator that every skier and snowboarder needs. My name is Tim Albano. I am a junior engineering management major here, and I've been skiing for about 6 years now.
I'm Hao Ji. I'm senior mechanical engineering major and focused on snowboard for 3 years.
Hello everybody, my name is Jameson Dugan. I am a senior mechanical engineering major as well, and I've been skiing for about as long as I can walk.
I'm Daniel Kelly. I'm also a senior mechanical engineer. I've been snowboarding for 2 years now. We came together as a senior project team. We made progress on our product design and realized its potential for retail success. And then when entering the Mayo Business Competition, we thankfully got the help from Tim. So a total of 13.8 million Americans ski or snowboard each year. And for every 1,000 visits, 2.6 result in a ski injury and around 6 result in a snowboarding injury. There has been a 15% decrease in operational ski resorts over the last 30 years, but an increase in participation throughout the country. So with decreased slope availability and increased participation, a strong market for land training emerges. Our product, AlpineAid, the land training solution every skier and snowboarder needs. We have engineered the most realistic ski and snowboard training system, and we plan to place this land training solution in ski resorts and shops all across the US as a revenue generating device for both for the shops, resorts, and our company. Our product goal is to simulate ski and snowboard movement, to train the user's muscle memory to prevent injury on the mountain, as well as to allow users to test new gear and so that they can buy them with confidence. Our product design is robust and interchangeable. It supports ski and snowboard training. The oscillating platform simulates a ski slope. There is 4 degrees of freedom, and it allows for personal mounting of equipment. Our product consists of a platform and sloping mechanism, which simulates a ski slope to provide a realistic experience to the user. It has an oscillating angle from 0 to 20 degrees, and for safety, we have a railing and emergency stop.
Our ski system was designed to address the dynamic motions a skier performs when traveling down the mountain. Based on our prior experiences, as well as some preliminary research, we were able to design mechanical systems that provide rotation, translation, and edge-to-edge movements of the skis. All our mechanisms are designed to integrate seamlessly with one another, so that you can perform all these motions simultaneously for a really simulated ski experience. Our edge-to-edge and rotational mechanisms are novel design mechanisms, which we hope will help contribute to the successful granting of a patent for our product. So this is the current status of our prototype. We have just begun the assembly of subsystems, so it's not much, but we can still see the support of the translational edge-to-edge and rotational movements. As we further work into the assembly of our product, we'll see it start to grow much more functionally as well as aesthetically within the coming days.
Here's the snowball system. As you can see, for the rotation system, by consider of the functionality and the economy efficiency, it's a minimized design for easy of assembly and the control of cost. So the turntable bearing was chosen. With the help of the quick release, the whole system can be built on the top over the ski rail. It can be established in a very short time. And here's the two videos for the snowball system. On the left side, we can see as an individual video for rotation and the edge-to-edge movement. On the right side, we combine together, and it's very easy to see. It can work very fluently.
Manufacturing of our device is accomplished by producing technical drawings of individual parts that come from extensively designed 3D models. Manufacturing currently is taking place by us in the TCNJ machine shop, but as we develop more prototypes and grow our company, we expect that 40% of our parts will have to be outsourced from third-party machining services, with the rest being assembled by us with readily available tools and devices. We expect that our AlpineAid will cost $2,212 to produce a single unit, but in further years of our business, we will invest in our own machinery, and with manufacturing in-house, we expect the cost to drive down to $1,551.
So we're really confident in our product, and we're equally confident in the markets that we're entering to support this business. $8.25 billion are spent on training in the US every year. 60 million annual ski resorts see an annual 60 million visits per year, with an average of around $700 in training per new user who wants to get into the sport. This is often a barrier that prevents people from getting into the sport, so we offer a solution to this with the AlpineAid by offering formal training at around 40% of the national average cost. An alternative market that we're also pursuing is ski shops, where $4.5 billion are spent on skiing and snowboarding equipment in the US every year. At the peak season, ski shops can see around 20 sales per day, and these sales for the full setup of a ski and snowboard can range between $600 to $1,500, which is a very significant investment. So you want to make sure that you get your fit right and you get the product right. And our product offers a solution for that in ensuring a proper fit for the skiers in the ski shops.
Here are some ski trainers currently in the market. AlpineAid can provide both ski and snowboard trainer. So we have the full body protection, the sport use of the personal boots. The most important thing is that we have the basic ski capabilities that the other products do not have. Here's the line-to-line comparison. It's very obvious to see that we have a very good stance in the market.
So I want to clarify a fundamental difference between our product and existing products on the market. Everything on the market right now is more of a ski exercise equipment, similar to an elliptical or a treadmill. It's not a true ski simulator. That's where our product addresses the issues that other consumers have already identified with these products. So in fixing these issues and expanding to create a real ski simulator, we're fitting the needs that our potential customers desire.
Here's the future of our product. First, after testing our original mechanism, some sketches can be simplified to save the use of the materials. And we have a new design for the rotation system. The resistance can be dynamically adjusted in order to have a high degree of realism. It's very easy to be assembled and manufactured. Also can reduce the cost, and the sensors can be also added on to have the analyzation of the motion data. Also, the VR simulation is also available as the sensors feedback.
We do recognize that there may be some barriers going to market that we will need to overcome. The first being that businesses may be hesitant to adopt our new product. We plan to mitigate this by offering our product to businesses at no cost, assuming the maintenance and the liability of the product as well. There is also a limited number of ski resorts and shops, meaning there is a ceiling to the places we can market to and the places we can offer our device. But fortunately, our pricing model generates revenue continuously, so it will always be profitable. Our initial target market will consist first of ski shops and training centers, along with ski resorts. At shops and training centers, more advanced users can come in to utilize the device for accessible off-mountain training closer to home than their average ski resort. It'll also allow customers to demo equipment easily, which is a unique feature of our product. The try before you buy, if you want to come in and try out different ski boots, snowboard bindings, and snowboard boots, you can utilize that on the device. At ski resorts, it'll draw beginner skiers to come in who may be a little scared of going out on the mountain for the first time. They can use the device in a lesson setting. This will help minimize injuries on the mountain due to inexperience, and will also introduce new revenue to the resort.
Hey guys, a quick question for you. I saw the prototype, but when will you guys actually mount a snowboard or a ski to the actual prototype?
So that is the next step. We've just begun assembling all our subsystems. So I know the last time you were curious about the mounting of the boots. So we found demo bindings that we could utilize. So we just have a mounting system that we'll attach on top.
Gotcha. And I think last time we talked about doing some market research. Have you guys talked to any of like the
yes.
mountains? All right, great.
We will get into that later.
Yes, gotcha. So we'll go in full depth to that in a couple minutes.
Sounds good to me. Thanks.
So we want our product to appeal to skiers and snowboarders from the very, very beginner to the expert level. For beginners, we see them utilizing the device in the resort setting where they can come in and test themselves before going on the mountain for the first time so that they feel comfortable and learn the fundamentals of the sports. Resort employees can also utilize the device to ensure the comfort and function of the rental gear that people are, that first timers are using. If they don't know how a ski boot or a snowboard boot can fit, they can try it out so they can feel safe and secure. It also allows first timers to try both skiing and snowboarding in a controlled and simulated environment. And they can choose which sport is best suited for them based off that. And then more for the advanced users, we expect them to utilize our product in the ski shop setting, where they can come in to practice their skills, regardless of how much snow is on the ground or how the weather is that day. And we'll also allow them to test new equipment before purchasing it. Our product offers an array of potential services in both group and individual settings, along with or without an instructor present. So in order to grow our product, we have already started by surveying local ski clubs and ski shops just to gauge the interest in our product and the impact it may have. We visited a local ski shop right here in Ewing, and they were extremely excited about the device and the features it offered. They thought the biggest selling point and the coolest aspect was the try before you buy capabilities of boot fitting. They gave some really good feedback as well as some insight to potential design design solutions, and they're patiently waiting for a demonstration of a prototype. So once we have the prototype, we'll set up video and demonstrations just to gain the product and showcase its features. We will advertise to resorts and shops our device as a revenue generating device where customers will come in and pay to use it. Then we'll offer the AlpineAid to resorts and shops at no cost under the agreement that we collect a portion of the profits generated. With our first four models out at resorts and shops, we'll continue demonstrations, interactive testing days, and trade shows just to continue to grow the product and hopefully gather some valuable feedback. And then we plan to expand to multiple devices at multiple resorts across the country, have deals and promotions set up with ski shops, and then eventually shift our marketing to the at-home users so that you and I could purchase this product and shove it in the basement and ski all year round.
So now the market survey data that we've been waiting for. We were able to survey over 100 participants and get responses back from them, from 100 participants, ranging in ages from under 18 up to 65 years old. And we have proportionate representation of each sport, whether skiing, snowboarding, or both, and then near equal representation of all skill levels. So we really captured the opinions of the full ski market that we're actually going to enter. We found that there was a disproportionately high percentage of advanced respondents with a low need for a land training system compared to the surveyed population, while in conjunction with that, we found that there was a disproportionately high percentage of users with no experience who had a high need for a land training solution. So what does that mean for us? That really just means that participants with no prior experience have a greater need for the AlpineAid utilized specifically as a training solution. We've identified multiple other uses for our product, but we know that we need to target this training solution specifically for those with no experience before. Our data showed that 88.2% of respondents said that they would personally use the AlpineAid to train in learning how to ski and snowboard if it was an option available at the time or going forward if they haven't already learned. And we found that 86.3% of respondents were willing to pay an additional fee to test new gear before purchasing to ensure comfort. Going off of some more usage responses, we see that the most popular usage perception is for beginner training, gear fitting coming in second place, and then continued training for advanced skiers was third most popular. But we found that a warm-up and cool-down option for the AlpineAid already at the mountain was not as popular, so we've adjusted our strategy accordingly, and we're not going to pursue that as much. Our previous assumption of $30 per half-hour price point was also confirmed by the survey data, and we found that it actually maximizes our revenue generation potential. So that is the price point that we will choose going forward. Now, how do we make money? Jameson mentioned earlier that the AlpineAid is going to be placed in a resort or a shop at no cost to either party. This keeps our barriers to entry low and keeps the risk for a resort low when they're a resort or shop low when they're adopting our product that hasn't really been on the market yet. So in a training venue, the specific location will charge visitors a fee per training session. That's going to be a fixed $30 per half hour session. In the fitting use, the venue can charge a fitting fee per purchase. We're assuming a 5% per gear price. It'll be an upcharge of 5% from the AlpineAid for the use of the AlpineAid. At that point, we'll collect a percentage of the total revenue generated from our product. Right now we have a 30% split for us and a 70% split for the resort and shop, making it a very attractive deal for resorts adopting our product. Now this pricing model is actually already proven. It's similar to what some healthcare equipment manufacturers do. They'll place their equipment in a hospital and then their revenue that they create is based off of the usage percentage. It's based off usage. It's important to note also that AlpineAid, we own and maintain all the machines. So that means that we'll have to pay for continued upkeep of it, but we also have the freedom to allocate our resources wherever is most beneficial. So whether we find one of these uses is not as good as the other, we can, after our contract period is up, maintain our product and go into the more successful field. So we have three modes of revenue generation with the AlpineAid: beginner training at ski resorts, gear testing at ski shops, and then advanced training at ski shops. At ski resorts, who see an average of 130,000 visits annually, 6.15% of those are beginners. So we're really reliant on this high foot traffic that's already at the resort. We recognize that we're not the main point of contact at these ski resorts. The mountains is the attraction for the resorts. That being said, we're focusing primarily on beginners because the beginners need a convenient one-stop training solution. They're not going to want to travel to a ski shop and then travel an hour away back to the mountain to actually get on the mountain. So it's better to reach those who are already traveling to the mountain for that day, offer them a quick half-hour training session, and then get them on the mountain a lot safer. Similarly, we recognize that advanced users don't really have as high of a need for our product at ski resorts specifically. They arrive at the mountain and they already know how to ski, so they want to get on the mountain faster. 89% of our survey respondents said that they would personally use the AlpineAid to learn how to ski and snowboard. Even if only 20% of these new visitors want to spend less money improving their skills in a safer environment, an AlpineAid is still capable of generating $48,000 in total revenue per year. Our second mode of revenue generation is gear testing at ski shops. Ski shops can sell about 20 skis per day during the peak season, and we recognize the added value that our product adds to these purchases. We're ensuring a proper fit on an expensive investment. So because of that, stores can charge either a fixed fitting fee or a percentage of the equipment per purchase. That would come out, if it's 5%, to around $30 on a low-end $600 purchase, but we know that they can go up in excesses of $1,500 for a setup. So 86% of our survey respondents said that they're willing to pay extra for a proper fit. Conservatively assuming only 40% of gear buyers actually want to use our equipment in store to test their new purchase, one AlpineAid can generate $42,000 in ski shops from gear testing alone. However, they'll serve a dual purpose in ski shops. Advanced users can also use our equipment to train in shops because we're more likely to reach advanced users in specialty shops who are already there buying equipment, and it gives the shops an opportunity to kind of cross-sell their gear if they're also already there training. We're not reliant on the foot traffic because, unlike ski resorts, our product is going to be the main focus at this shop. It can bring new customers into a ski shop. And on average in New Jersey, a ski shop serves 5,600 skiers and snowboards in the region. So if we capture a percentage of that, we can generate a significant amount of revenue. About one half of survey participants indicated that they're interested in advanced land training. Even if only very conservatively 1% of advanced users train at a ski shop an average of one time per month, the AlpineAid can generate an additional $20,000 in ski shops from advanced training. So to summarize all of that, we have in ski resorts, we would take home around $14,400 from one single unit per year. In ski shops serving this dual purpose, we would take home a total of $18,500 per year from those two uses. Again, these are just our projections, but it's also important to remind us that we own the product still. We haven't sold any product, so if one of these are found to be different playing out in reality, we can reallocate our resources to the more successful venture.
We do recognize that skiing and snowboarding are seasonal activities. We see that most of the operations occur from January to March, and we have accounted for this in our financial projections. With the $30,000 first place prize money, this would support production of our first four units, with the majority of the money going towards patent and legal fees, along with the materials and the manufacturing of our product. We'd also be renting an industrial facility in order to assemble these devices for the first 3 months. There's also a international standards organization guidelines and testing fee for equipment or training equipment that we have accounted for in our budget as well. And then we also have contingency plans for second and third prize as well.
So we can take a deeper dive into what the first few years of operations might look like for us. In the first year, we're not going to sell any product. We're not even going to manufacture products until we've guaranteed the patent application process, which should take about a year and $10,000. During that time, we'll be conducting targeted outreach to resorts and shops to secure deals for our first few partners. And then by the end of the year, we hope to secure industrial spaces and manufacture the first 4 units. In our second year, we will enter ski resorts and shops during the off season, allocating 2 units to ski resorts and 2 units to ski shops. We'll produce and place an additional 4 units in time for the peak season, but at that point we will also need to seek an additional $5,400 in investment for that manufacturing. In year 3, we'll see the beginning of yearly off-season maintenance. We've allocated $300 per active unit, which we believe is very reasonable. And we'll produce an additional 8 units in the third year. Once again, half going to ski resorts and half going to ski shops for the purposes of these projections. In year 3, we'll also invest in all the machinery we need to make our product in-house, thus reducing the cost of outsourcing and reducing our overall cost of production. In year 4, we'll have the resources to hire a full-time manager who can take over day-to-day operations, and we'll produce and place an additional 16 units in-house. This will reflect in the lower cost of production. Overall, by the end of the 4th year, we're projecting $440,000 in gross profit with a steady rise because we're consistently doubling our active units. Our projected net profit and loss after tax is around $260,000, and that dip in year 3 is just because we chose a cash-based financing system or financial reporting. So that's the year that we bought our expensive equipment and invested in that. The $28,151 is the total cost of our startup, which is covered by the Mayo first place prize that we've assumed.
Thank you, Tim. If all goes well, we'll grow our business until a comfortable selling point is reached, in which we will sell our business to an established equipment manufacturer. If our projections are unsustainable, we're going to drop unsustainable revenue moats in favor of others. We'll sell our patent and then distribute that gain amongst the team.
So overall, we're really confident in the product that we've built and really confident in the business that we're developing. We know that there's a need for our AlpineAid because there's a decreasing number of ski slopes that can't support the growing population. Our product offers a unique solution to multiple problems faced by skiers and snowboarders. We're improving the skills of beginners and even experts on the mountain, and we empower customers to purchase gear with confidence in the future. We'll make money in a beneficial revenue-generating model for all parties involved, and our product continuously generates revenue from year to year. There's versatile usage for each shop with the potential for expansion into the home use market, and overall just really strong potential for revenue generation in this untapped market for gear fitting and land training. So once again, we're very confident in our product and we're really excited to go forward with the startup. And we thank you all for your time. And we would now like to open the floor to any last questions.
Good job, guys. One question on the ISO safety. Did you look into that and how is that playing into your prototype? Because you're building the prototype now.
We've looked into how to obtain these ISO guidelines. We're in the process of ordering them. You actually need to order the guidebook, so we haven't specifically seen the guidebooks. We're following the standards for stationary training equipment. They do have a specific standard for stationary land training and exercise equipment, so we will be following those standards. We've identified the booklets that we need to do and how to test them, and we've budgeted for testing and adjustments, but we haven't specifically seen the design implications that they'll have yet.
Thank you for your presentation. My question is on the initial resorts where you're going to place your product. Have you identified the first 4 resorts where you want to place the AlpineAid, and have you contacted them to see if they were open to a product like the AlpineAid in the resort?
We know that we're going to stick around regionally for the first 4 units, or the first 2 resorts in the first year is what we'll do. So somewhere in New Jersey, New York. We haven't reached out to the resorts yet. We've focused this first stage of production or of outreach on the shops. So our next phase is to go into resorts, knowing that we still have the confidence in the shops to fall back on, even if they're not there. But we're going to stay in the region in New Jersey and New York starting, just to keep costs low for shipping. All right. Well, thank you all for your time, and thank you all for being here.
So you can see that this is indeed exciting. And so our next group should be coming in any second. I'm just looking. I'm always impressed at the timing. You know, they time all of these down. The sides, you know, progress so well. A lot of practice goes into this, a lot of work, a year's worth of work for these students. So it's really incredible.
I need a dollar, 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 that's what I need. Hey, hey.
So,
well, I need a dollar, 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 that's what I need.
So the next team is Witz Financial. And they will gear up their presentation. Just to remind the team, you have 30 minutes to present. You can be asked questions by the judges during your presentation. I would like to point out that Ms. D is down here in the front. She is the timekeeper, so please keep your eye on her, and she will alert you when 5 minutes is over. When you are ready to start, the microphones are over here behind me. When you are ready to start, just signal her so that she knows to start the timer.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. Thank you for being here. My name is Will Cunningham. I'm a senior finance student here at the College of New Jersey, and I'm the founder and CEO of Witz.
Hello, my name is Freddie Hayeck. I'm a senior interdisciplinary business major here at the college, and I'm the chief of strategy of Witz. And as you heard in the song, we're here for a dollar. It's very exciting to be here in front of all of you in the Mayo Concert Hall, because 4 years ago, Will and I met on this campus in Centennial Hall. And when we heard about the Mayo Business Plan competition, we were all in. Despite our hard work, we didn't make it very far. We failed miserably. We didn't make it to the second round, and the feedback we got from the judges were so positive that it left the impression of Will and me that we were missing a lot in our business plan. But despite that, we worked hard, and because of the resources of TCNJ, we came back, and we're here to compete today. So we want to give a special thanks to everyone for taking the time to come here and listen to our presentation. Special thanks to Dr. Mayo for establishing this program, and to Professor Szabo for supporting this. And thank you to the judges for taking your time and supporting us every step of the way to help improve our business. We listened to you loud and clear in the semifinals. We heard there were concerns about monetizing our business, and we've addressed that in our business plan, which we provided to you earlier, and we've included in our presentation. In particular, I know Ms. Weisbart and Mr. Worrell had some questions about how we're gonna generate revenue off our partnership models. We're excited to share with you how we're gonna do just that, and I'd like to pass it back over to Will to talk about Witz.
Thank you, Freddie. Just making sure we're getting to the next slide here. So what is the problem that we wanted to address with Witz? It's the idea that people know that they should be investing, but they don't know how much to invest and in which asset classes. Now, this problem was sparked for me by my grandfather, who should actually be watching the live stream now. I'm hoping he figured out how to connect to the Zoom, but thank you, Granddad, for the idea. So he called me and asked me for investment allocation advice. Now, he has a professional wealth manager from a large corporation, but he still reached out to me as a young finance student for simple, easy-to-follow financial allocation advice. So after discussing this problem with Freddie, he mentioned that his mother and other family members were experiencing a similar problem. So we took this problem to our peers at TCNJ and decided to see if this was a problem that they were also facing. And our initial interaction told us that this was true. But we wanted to confirm our hypothesis. So what we did was conducted a survey of TCNJ students, and what we found was that 76% of people wanted investment allocation advice, but 71% of people said that cost was a sticking point for them, meaning they wanted high quality investment allocation advice, but they didn't want to have to pay for it. Also, in these interactions, we found that people wanted simplicity in their investment allocation advice. Oftentimes, the information that is presented to them is too complex or convoluted. So they wanted a way to simply understand where they need to put their money. And so I'd like to talk a little bit further about what's currently available on the market. And the simple answer is it's inadequate. There's basic online calculators, but the problem with these is that the advice they provide is not personalized and tailored to that user. The information is also not updated as the market changes or as their personal situation changes. There's also investing apps and websites that are available that provide higher quality investment allocation advice, but they require management fees. They require a transfer of funds, and they also have minimum account balances. So that's where Witz was born. Our solution is a free, easy to use investment allocation tool that provides users with easy to understand and simple to a personalized allocation. Now with that, there is no management fees, no required transfer of funds, and no minimum account balances. We are a young and hungry team that are ready to make Witz a reality. We have broad domain expertise across finance, data science, design, and strategy. We are young, hungry, and motivated to bring Witz to the market. I'd like to talk a little bit more about how Witz actually works. So the first part is when a user signs up for the Witz app, we ask them a couple basic questions: how old they are, when they plan on retiring, their attitude towards risk. With this information, we can begin to create a financial picture of that user. After this, we allow the user to connect their financial accounts to the app, so their savings, brokerage accounts, crypto accounts, whatever it may be. With that, we can determine where they are currently allocated across which assets. Once this is done, we use our proprietary investment allocation tool to determine their optimal investment allocation across different asset classes, including US large cap stocks, real estate, commodities, etc. Once that's complete, we then track the user's net worth and can project it to when they stated they would like to retire. In addition to this, I'd like to note that the judges had called out a concern in the semifinals about the user's ability to effectively link their financial accounts to the Witz app. So Freddie and I discussed this and derived a solution. And that's video tutorials that are accessible within the app to give simple and easy to follow advice to these users on how to actually connect their financial accounts to the app. So we're giving clear examples, step by step, how to do this. So we make sure that people can effectively utilize all the functionality of Witz. Now, moving on, I'd like to talk a little bit about how our allocation methodology. I mentioned our proprietary investment allocation tool. So the way this works is, again, first by onboarding user information. We gather basic data points about each user, and this allows us to construct the maximum allowable volatility that that user can experience in an investment year. Then we use the power of machine learning and modern portfolio theory to construct an optimal portfolio that is going to maximize expected return for that user given the maximum allowable volatility that has been determined. I'd also like to note the data we are using encompasses 15 years of trading. And this is so that we can capture a full credit cycle so that we can deliver high quality investment advice to users, regardless of where we are at in the economic cycle. Up here, we have listed two example outputs for two different users at different stages in their investment life cycle, a younger user and an older user. This should demonstrate the classes that we are allocating users into, as well as the expected annual return, volatility, and their expected net worth at retirement. I would now like to turn it over to Freddie to talk a little bit about what makes Witz different.
Thank you, Will. One of the pieces of feedback that we received from the judges in the semifinals was their concern that Witz would fail to be a one-stop shop for all users and everyone. And Will and I couldn't agree more. That's not what we want Witz to be. Witz is different. We're trying to target a young investor that's new and provide them with a valuable, personalized service that provides them simple, easy-to-follow investment advice. Nothing more. And we've taken that as part of our identity and incorporated it into our four competitive advantages. Our first is a commitment to a no-cost structure. Witz does not charge an account management fee, unlike our competitors. Other competitors in the market charge an account management fee that range from 0.25% all the way up to 2%. And the reason why Witz didn't want to do this is because we learned from our surveys and testimonials that cost was a barrier. So we did without that. With those testimonials and surveys conducted, we also learned that people were inundated with an excess amount of information. They couldn't follow investment advice that they received online. So Witz took that feedback and we incorporated it into the design and functionality of our service. So anyone that uses our service can have easy to follow, simple advice to maximize their investing allocation provided to them from our service. The third tenet of our competitive advantage is a commitment to a personalized, tailored experience. Each user will be provided with a unique investment allocation that's specific to their risk tolerance, their financial position, their goals, and other relevant factors. This puts us apart from our competitors because others broadly group together demographic groups and don't take into account their specific risk tolerance and other specific factors. And lastly, Witz is committed to being accessible. Other robo-advisors in the market require a transfer of funds or a minimum account balance. And we know that's a barrier to people to even use robo-advisors. So Witz did without that, because we look at our service as an ability to address the financial advice gap that exists so that anybody, regardless of the socioeconomic status, can use our service. Witz wants to capitalize on the growing consumer sentiment and industry trends. One of those being is that 3 out of 4 people are not using traditional robo-advisors. So you might be asking yourself, where are they going to get their advice? Well, people are overwhelmingly turning to the internet and robo-advisors to get their advice. And there's a growing number of young people doing that. And it's those young people that we want to target. Mr. Lucia, I remember there in the semifinals, you said your daughter, who's in school at Charleston, would use this service. I know when I got my first part-time job, my family told me, save your money, invest it. And I'm sure there's students in the audience that got their first full-time job and were told by their family, save your money, invest it. It's sound advice, but it's not always easy to follow. And it's those people that we want to target. So that demographic of 18 to 29 is our targeted demographic that gives us a market size of 30 million users. And this is an attractive industry because we projected the industry revenue to be over $40 billion in the next 5 years. Now, to capitalize on this attractive and growing industry, Witz is going to do 3 things. The first is finfluencer partnerships. These are individuals on social media, where all the young people are on, Instagram, TikTok, YouTube. These are people that provide free, simple-to-follow financial advice to the young demographic, who we're targeting and has the same mission as us. We've already reached out to different finfluencers to do this. One of them being Captain Cash. He has a total follower base of 76,000 users, has agreed to work with us, agrees with the mission of Witz, and is excited about the partnership. We're also looking for ways to expand our finfluencer partnerships with those that have broad demographic groups so that everybody can feel included to use our service. In addition to these finfluence partnerships, we're going to rely on word of mouth and organic social media growth because we believe in the value of our service and that people are going to want to use it and share it with their peers. One of the beauties of software is its scalability. We can onboard and expand our users for a minimal cost, and we can expand the functionality and service of our company. To that goal, Will and I are constantly looking at ways to improve our business. We've thought about 3 different ways to improve the functionality of Witz. The first is credit card optimization. When I was looking to get my first credit card, I was overwhelmed by the different credit cards out there. And I know during the semifinals, Ryan had a similar experience when he looked at me and smiled. Do you get a credit card based off of you want to travel or do you want hotels? Do you spend more on groceries or do you spend more on gas? If you have that data in front of you, you can make an informed decision. And Witz is going to do that by analyzing the spending habits of our users. On the same note of optimization, we're going to analyze the trading and investment habits of our users to recommend to them the best brokerage service for them based off of their goals and financial position. Again, this is going to be able to provide our users with a simple advice on how to invest their money. And thirdly, we understand our users. We understand that young people are interested in cryptocurrencies. They want to diversify their portfolio of cryptocurrencies. So Witz is going to include cryptocurrencies into people's unique investment allocation strategies if they choose to. And finally, our strong service puts us as an industry leader above beyond the competitors in the market. Our two closest competitors is Wealthfront and Betterment. Now, these two companies both either charge a minimum account balance, a required transfer of funds, or a management fee. But again, Witz learned that these were barriers for people to use robo-advisors, so we did without them. Another competitor is Personal Capital. But Personal Capital is not accessible. You need a net worth of $100,000 to even use their service. Witz wants to ensure that anybody, regardless of their socioeconomic status, can use our service. Another competitor to note is Mint. Mint is a free-to-use app, but it doesn't provide its users with a personalized investment allocation. Now, I'd like to pass it over to Will, that's going to talk about how we'll turn our superior service into a viable business and generate the revenue that the judges wanted to see.
Thank you, Freddie. So, Freddie had mentioned that one of the core tenets of our business is a commitment to a cost-free structure for our users. So how are we going to make money? And the answer to that is a referral fee model. So how does that look in practice? Well, we are going to have a partnerships page within our app that is going to feature other companies in the financial technology space. Now, customers or users of Witz can navigate to that partnerships page and utilize referral links of those partner companies and sign up for their services. And when that happens, Witz will get a fee from that partner. So for example, credit card companies typically expect to pay about $200 to onboard a new user. Now, if Witz charges a referral fee of about 30% of that cost, about $60, we can deliver a savings to that partner of about $140. Now, you can start to see the value to partners of why they might want to use or partner with a platform like Witz. Now, we have some alternative revenue streams in mind, including using the high-quality data insights that we are going to generate through our service to do targeted advertisements. Now, in practice, this might be look like when a new partner joins the Witz app. We can send a push notification to all relevant users to let them know that a partner that may be interesting to them has just joined our service and to come check out whatever deals or offerings they have available on the Witz partnership page. Now, one of the concerns that the judges had highlighted about Witz during the semifinals was our ability to effectively utilize a referral fee model to generate substantial revenue, as well as go and actually capture partners to join our service. So what we would like to do is first outline five distinct benefits of using a referral fee model. The first of which is that this type of revenue model benefits both our users and our partners. So when you think of a Betterment or a Wealthfront, some of our closest competitors, these companies are using a percentage of asset under management fee model to generate revenue. Now, the problem with that is that the users are losing out because they have to pay for this investment advice that they're getting from these services. Now, on our cost-free model, users aren't paying anything. But we're also driving value for our partners because they're able to acquire new users at a discount from what they would typically expect to pay in the market. Now, the second benefit I'd like to highlight is that Witz, our entity, will not have to register with the Securities and Exchange Commission. Because our revenue differs from the asset under management model, we won't have to be held to the same regulatory standards that our competitors are. So this will save us time and money. The next point I'd like to talk about is that our competitors are currently engaged in a race to the bottom in terms of the fees that they can charge their users. Because our competitors are becoming more and more mature and it's costing them more to onboard new users, they have to lower the fees that they're charging users in order to remain competitive. Witz flips the script on our revenue model, and we won't have to participate in this revenue or this margin squeezing activity. Now, moving on to that, potential acquirers will benefit from the differing revenue model that Witz can offer. We can smooth cash flows for a potential acquirer and offer an alternative to them rather than other competitors in the robo-advisory space. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, customer acquisition costs in the financial technology space are rising. So partners in this space or financial technology companies are going to be looking for platforms like Witz that can give them high quality advertising spaces for lower cost. And that's why we believe we can be effective with this referral fee model. I'd like to call your attention to three successful examples of a referral fee model: Mint, NerdWallet, and Bankrate. I'd like to note that in 2017, Bankrate was acquired for $1.2 billion. As you can see, there's clear market interest and demand for a referral fee model, and we know that we can be successful with this type of model. Now, to the judge's concern of our ability to onboard new partners, we've listed up here some potential partners of Witz. These are companies that we've already reached out to and begun discussions with about what a partnership with Witz looks like, how it benefits them, and how we can drive value for them. Our strategy is to scale the size of the partners that we're working with to drive value for our users and give them the offers and deals that are going to most benefit them. Witz is projecting $7.3 million in year 5 in revenue. Now, we've arrived at this estimate through three basic assumptions. The first of which is that we will we'll convert 1% of our users to referrals. Now, we've arrived at this estimate through a conservative approach, given that our research puts the financial technology referral conversion rate closer to 2.3%. So we're confident we can achieve this mark. Our second assumption is that each referral that we generate will give us an average of $50 in revenue. And third, we expect to grow our monthly user base by 13.1%. We've arrived at this mark by taking a discount of what our competitors have seen during their growth phases. So we're confident that we can achieve these financial metrics that we've laid out for you today. Now, Freddie and I are supremely grateful for this opportunity to be here today, and we know that participating in the Mayo Business Plan has already improved our business. But ultimately, we're here today to put the prize money to good use, to help grow and scale our app. So $10,000 of the $30,000 of prize money will be utilized to improve our app. We know that our success comes down to our ability to create a product that people love and want to share with their friends. And so we know that this is going to be important in terms of allocating the prize money. We have other costs, including legal fees, marketing expenses, as Freddie mentioned, our $5,000 lead marketing plan. We will have costs associated with growing and scaling our app in terms of our hosting capacities, which we have allocated $3,500 of the prize money to in our first year. For the sake of time, I would like to skip over these financial statements here, but if the judges have any questions specifically pertaining to our three main financial statements, I'm happy to go over those. The one thing I would like to note is that in our first year, we are projecting a loss in net income, but by year 5, we are expecting strong net income with high margins, and so we're very excited about that. Now, to conclude, Freddie and I would just like to give you a summary of what Witz is, where we differ, and where we are planning to go in the future. So what is Witz? Witz is a free, easy-to-use investment allocation tool that provides users with a personalized investment allocation. as well as net worth tracking and projection functionality. Freddie?
Thank you, Will. Witz will stand to be an industry leader for commitments to our four competitive advantages: a no-cost structure, a commitment to simplicity, a personalized tailored experience from user to user, and a commitment to accessibility so that anybody interested can use our service. Through these four distinct competitive advantages, Witz will stand to become the market leader in providing advice to the next generation of financial investors. We want to thank you all for being here today. Thank you to the judges for this opportunity. Will and I are committed to seeing Witz come off the ground, and we're proud to have TC&J be part of our story. So if there's any students here interested in learning more about Witz after this competition, we would love to talk to you about being a user and giving out some t-shirts. Everyone loves some free stuff, and together we can put your money where you need it. Thank you so much. We're not gone. We're not gone. Yes.
Good.
Do you guys want it?
Good. Question on the SEC. I know you say because of the revenue model, it's not a traditional revenue model, so you're outside of the scope of that. But have you really sought counsel on that, because you are providing advice and you are analyzing securities on behalf of the users on your system?
It's a great question. So we've actually engaged the law firm Thompson & Hine to counsel us on this topic. What they've done for us is provided very clear examples of what kind of business we can engage in and what we can't. So Freddie and I know the partners that we can make and what we can't do. We know exactly what to avoid. What they've also provided to us is language for partners to explain to them and reassure them why we can operate as an unregistered entity, to make sure that these partnerships go smoothly and they understand we've done our homework, we know we can do this, and we know here's exactly why. So hopefully that answers your question.
One other question, if I may, on revenue. Your growth, you're projecting revenues on 1% of conversions to partners, and I understand that. But you're carrying a lot of customers coming onto the platform, so technology is not free. Have you factored that into your costs in terms of customers coming on, using the platform, but maybe not connecting with your partners? So you've got a cost of maintaining the profile of the customer, but not necessarily the benefit to you in terms of the revenue.
So that's a great point. And one of the things we've done to address the referral conversion rate, and for us, a lot of the success of our business is going to come down to how many people can we actually refer to our partners. And so we've devised a Witz points program that when a user signs up for a partner service, they get in-app Witz points that they can then spend in the form of currency at partner companies. We have another potential solution to this problem, including a customer loyalty program, whereas the more referrals that these our users engage in, then they will be entered into raffles and other giveaways that we will sponsor as Witz to encourage people to actually sign up for these partners, because we know that's so important to these partners in terms of delivering them value.
And just on that topic real quickly, that was revisions that we've included into our business plan from the suggestions or the recommendations you provided to us about how to incentivize our users to really go to those partnership pages, because we're trying to make a marketplace of people looking for related services. And so these two plans that we'll address is one step to accomplish that.
Just a follow-up, a good presentation, by the way. Just
Thank
a follow-up to what you talked about with the legal firm. So have you actually also discussed kind of privacy, making sure that you've got an agreement with your client using the app so that they're not holding you liable if, in fact, this investment allocation that you're providing results in some financial loss to them?
All of those disclosures are included in our privacy policy when the user first, and we're using actually a different law firm to construct, because we know that the nature of our app is pretty complex. So we've engaged another law firm to help us construct our privacy policy. We make sure we have all the relevant disclosures to let them know that we are not liable for financial losses. And We've also included, as I mentioned, Plaid. Plaid is a third-party provider that is going to connect financial accounts for us. They have their own disclosures that ensure the privacy of their financial assets, et cetera. So we've made sure we've thought through all of these processes to protect ourselves, as well as deliver the best possible value to our users that we can.
Great, thank you.
Oh, one final question. I know like the big thing here is the app. So how far in development has that been? Have you guys talked to any software developers and stuff like that?
The app is fully in production. Our concern is more about putting a high quality product out on the App Store rather than rushing anything. So tentative timeline is about 8 weeks from now. Building an app, as you'd imagine, is quite a complicated process, especially one of a financial nature. But yes, Ryan, to answer your question, we've engaged several software developers and we're fully in development. The train has left the station, which is going to happen. So hopefully that answers your question.
With the software development, how are you testing the model? You're saying it's a proprietary model. So, are you having a separate group of people black box test it? How are you looking at that to make sure it's really working as you intend and when people rely on it?
So we've back tested the model. So what we can do is basically create scenarios that historically have happened. How would our recommendations have performed? And so what really our model is all about is maximizing expected return for the maximum allowable volatility of that user. And what we found through our back testing is on par, if not superior to competitor allocations. And so we've been working on this app for many months at this point, and most of it was about creating a really solid allocation model. And so we wanted to make sure that, because that was the engine that is going to drive the car of Witz, so we wanted to make sure that that was as best as can be. So hopefully that answers your question. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And here comes our final team. There are microphones right here that you can grab. So the final team is eLuminate. And so I'll just again remind them of the rules. So you have 30 minutes for your presentation. In this particular round, the judges may interrupt you to ask questions, so just be aware of that. Ms. D is down here at the front, and she is again our timekeeper for this. She's got a 5-minute warning for you. When you are ready to start, then please indicate to her that you're ready to go, and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for joining us today. We are eLuminate. We're very excited to share our business and presentation with you, eLuminate. The world is dark half the day, and lighting isn't going anywhere anytime soon, but it is changing in the way we choose to efficiently and effectively brighten our worlds. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce to you the eLuminate team. So my name is Christopher Caniglio. I'm a senior economics major. I run a small micro business, and I'm going to be leading marketing and finance for eLuminate.
Hi, I'm Andrew Majewitz. I'm a senior computer engineering student here at the college. I oversee all software development on the team, and I'm also the lead developer for the Android application.
Hi, I'm Jack Tomkiel. I'm also a computer engineering major, and I'm the head of prototyping, firmware development, and iOS development.
And I'm Bryce Bishop. I am the team lead on hardware manufacturing.
So a little bit about our company background. The eLuminate product began as a senior project for the School of Engineering and is being advised by Dr. Larry Perlstein in this Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering. So a little bit about our mission statement. Team eLuminate plans to offer the lowest cost and highest quality LED lighting solution to modular systems on the market. And for our vision statement, we plan to expand the efficiency, versatility, and accessibility of lighting systems through various innovations and new designs. So getting into the current market, the LED market currently is valued at about $76 billion as of the year 2020. And this is expected to rise up to about $160 billion by the year 2026. And over this course of time, it's also expected to have a projected compound annual growth rate of around 14%. So this shows that LEDs are currently the fastest growing lighting segment on the market, and they're being widely adopted across the globe. You can walk into stores such as Home Depot or Lowe's, and most devices, bulbs, and systems you'll see on shelves are all LED-based. This is because LEDs are significantly better than their predecessors and counterparts, such as incandescent bulbs. They're more efficient and have fewer carbon emissions. So now getting into some of the advantages of our lighting system. eLuminate panels offer a color rendering index of 90. So what CRI basically is a numerical value that represents how well the natural color of the object stands out in this light. So for a point of reference, 85 is a value considered, well, 85 and higher are the values considered to be best representative of natural light and natural colors. So in the figure you can see with the object, the color rendering index of 95 shows that the colors of the object are bright, vibrant, and truly stand out, whereas under a CRI of around 50, they appear very drab and dull. So in the next figure, you can see that this is a figure of our lab workspace. It's shot with an iPhone, and this section of the lab was strictly lit up by a single one of our panels. So you can see how well the colors in this picture really pop out in respect to, like, the notebooks, for example, where the red, blue, and yellow really are vibrant, and the white of the water bottle really pops. So as for our product, the standard eLuminate package will contain 5 LED panels and a power supply priced at $79.99. Our system is a modular design, which means that users can interconnect these panels in whatever pattern or shape they so choose. Our product also outputs the full color spectrum, so users can output warm white light, cool white light, red light, green light, and blue light, and can also blend these colors however they so choose. These colors are easily blended and instantly blended and output via our wireless Bluetooth application. So you can see the figure right there. The Android app is the current user interface we have that shows how users can really select whatever colors they want and blend it however they so choose. And the top right figure demonstrates the modularity concept of our current prototype, where the interconnectability of the boards functions, and we have a fully functioning prototype with all the LEDs currently lit up.
All right, so moving on to uses and applications. So the primary use of eLuminate is for lighting in a home or office. So one single panel can illuminate up to 200 square feet. And you can imagine, combined together, we can light up a much larger space. Additionally, with the full color capability, we could be used as decorative or accent lighting in a home. And the modular design, as Andrew said, allows the user to have creative freedom and put the panels however they so choose. And additionally, there's no electrician required for installation, which is a plus for the consumer. Additionally, our panels have a very bright white light capability, so this can be used to imitate natural light. So if you live in an area that doesn't get a lot of sunlight during certain times of the years, or your office or room just doesn't have any windows, our product can help ease that and even lessen things like seasonal depressive disorders. And additionally, since we have this high natural color capability, we can be used in a bathroom setting where, for cosmetic purposes, where, you know, rich and natural colors are very important. So as you can see on the right here, we just have an example figure with a bathroom. And you can see on the left, there's a lower quality light source compared to the right, a higher quality light source. And you can see how the colors appear much more natural and vibrant. And up top there, you can see how our product might be able to be used for, you know, bright lighting in an office or accent lighting in a home with the red, green, and blue functionality. So moving on to our operating plan. So we plan to have our product fully manufactured by JLC PCB, which is an overseas printed circuit board company. And our schematics and firmware will be sent to JLC, and they're going to assemble our product, package it, and send it back to us. And as far as sales go, we're going to do that through our own e-commerce website, and we plan to initially limit sales to the US only to ease shipping costs and potential taxes involved. And we're going to ship the product directly from our warehouse to the consumers here in the US. Now on the right here is our component sheet, and Bryce is going to talk a little bit more about that.
Thank you, Jack. So as we mentioned, this was a senior project, so we are very well aware of what components are specifically needed to develop this product. In order to develop 2,000 units, we know exactly the cost, and after consulting our advisor, we even believe that through even economies of scale and through just his own expertise, we believe that this cost could even be lowered over time.
So eLuminate has a number of competitive advantages, and when we designed the product, we didn't want the consumer to have to sacrifice performance just for a low cost. So our product was designed to be more affordable than any of our competitors on the market, like Nanoleaf and Govi. And our high brightness and color rendering capability allows the user to simulate natural light. And the smartphone control via Bluetooth excels in environments where some of our competitors, like Philips Hue, do not. Since we communicate over Bluetooth, we can be used in an office setting or a dorm room where some of the competitors that use Wi-Fi cannot be used. And our competitive pricing at $79 a package, that opens us up to a wider demographic, more than some of our more expensive competition. So some of our direct competitors, as I mentioned, are Nanoleaf, Govi, and Illumination, and some of our indirect competitors are LIFX, Philips, Lutron, and Paul C. Buff, which specializes in photography lighting.
So now getting into the gap map analysis, we wanted to specifically see as a new company where we would fall on a scale related to the cost of our product and the overall quality of this product. So we found a gap in the industry where there was an opportunity to have a quality light at a low cost. If we look at Nanoleaf and Govi, they both provide a very decent quality light, but at a very high cost, while Philips Lighting offers a very generic solution to this problem, but they have a very, not nearly as good of a quality as we have. We have a 90 CRI, Nanoleaf and Govi have only an 80 CRI. So now getting into our SWOT analysis, every new business is going to have their strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats, and we as a company need to be able to identify those. So as we said, with our strengths, we are the brightest, most accurate modular LED panel on the market, and this is a product that is designed by the same demographic that we're initially targeting. We are the people that we know would be using this, so who better to design this than us? Some of the opportunities we have, as Jack mentioned with some of the use cases, this applies to photography, videography, live streaming, and as we mentioned, some of the home decor and even office use. There's also, as I mentioned previously in the previous slide, there is a gap in the industry for a low-cost, high-quality solution. So, as a new company, we need to identify our weaknesses and understand how we can possibly address them in the future. We know that as a new company, there is a lack of brand recognition, so we're going to have to heavily invest in our marketing to get our name out there. There's a high expected cost of customer acquisition. Since we are a new company, we need to make sure that we can acquire customers in order to keep the business alive. And since we are only relying on JLC PCB, based on their costs could change at any given moment. So that's a little bit of a weakness of ours, where we understand that their costs are going to directly influence our costs. And it'll be a little tricky financing a larger expansion down the line, since we're going to eventually grow this business and watch it evolve. Some of the threats in this business is that there's always going to be a change in customer preferences. What one customer wants this month is going to be completely different 3 months and even a year from now. So we need to make sure that we're able to address those kind of changing preferences. And we know that since this is an evolving field, this is an LED-based system. So down the line, there may be something that comes along that's a little bit better than LEDs. So we need to be able to evolve and address and be able to adapt to the ever-evolving industry that is this very technological industry. And as we saw, it is a very highly competitive industry. Nanoleaf, Govi all have their own corners of the market. So we need to be able to carve out our own corner of the market with our own business plan. Now, getting into the marketing plan, we will primarily be marketing through social media and streaming platforms. This first marketing plan is in an attempt to address the audience of ages 15 to 35. These sites, such as Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, and Twitch, they all have a very high engagement with our target audience. So this is a perfect place for us to begin our marketing campaigns and to get our foothold in the industry. And we allocated $10,000 as an initial marketing budget for this plan. And so how exactly are we going to be advertising on here? We're going to be advertising by doing influencer promotions. We're going to be reaching out to these influencers to use our product on their sites, whether it's, as I said, Instagram, TikTok, whatever it is they do. We're reaching out to them, sending them free units, and let them show off our product however they produce their content. This is a very low cost, but has a very high exposure. This product only costs us $30 to make in a pack of five. So it's a very low cost as far as the resources are concerned in order to send them this product. And overall, so that the consumer or the producers are going to be well compensated, we're going to make sure that we're offering commission-based affiliate links at 7% based on what they bring in with the links that they give to their viewership. And that'll allow them to create and show their content based on how we give them our product to them. So an example on Twitch and YouTube, something as simple as a sponsor read. They even sometimes have a little bio in the bottom of their description of whatever video they produce. They simply shout us out, give the link of our website on there, and people can go in and order their eLuminate packages on there. On Instagram and TikTok, they're a very visual-based area as well, so anyone who's taking a picture with our product, anyone who's creating any sort of content with our product, will be able to use it, show it off, and show their consumers how much they enjoyed this product. So now getting into phase two of our marketing plan, we plan to make future investments down the line to break into an older demographic. This is an attempt to address the audience of ages 35 and up. We're going to introduce a new product line, such as book lamps, reading lights, anything along those lines. Obviously, this isn't reserved just for an older audience. This is simply an attempt to get more of an audience interested in this product with new, appealing products. We're going to be doing this primarily through Facebook and Google Ads. We found that this has a relatively high engagement with this target audience, similar to our previous marketing plan. And this has, we want to be able to expand this company, expand the overall audience that we have, and what better way than to try to address another audience there. So how will we be doing it? Specifically on Google Ads and Facebook Ads, we will be placing these ads on these platforms with a very high traffic of this target audience. And so on Google, they have something as simple as banner ads, also known as display ads, which are simply just links that pop up on the side of Google or even to some sites that are associated with Google that will allow them to say, hey, this looks pretty cool, let's check this out, and link them over to our website. Also on Facebook, they do image, video, and carousel ads, very similar, very visual for the person to see. This is the product, this is the website, let's go check it out. And now I'm gonna pass it over to Chris, who's gonna talk about the financials.
Yeah, so I'm gonna talk a little bit about our financial plan. And we determined that our ideal financing method would be crowdfunding. Crowdfunding has a couple advantages. First of all, it's zero long-term debt as opposed to investing with a bank or another form of investment. It aligns with our target audience. There's a lot of new products and a lot of young people are interested in new technology and new products. So we felt like this would be an ideal method to first create brand image for our company and also increase product exposure for our company. Our Indiegogo goal is going to be $100,000, and we're going to be assuming that 80% of this goal is met. With a 5% Indiegogo fee, this should bring our projected total raise to $76,000. And going over the impact of the prize money for the Mayo Business Competition, we're going to be really focusing on obtaining a patent first and foremost. That's our most valuable asset, our intellectual property. So we need to obtain a patent before we continue with any other phases of our business plan. Next, we talk about our marketing budget. As Bryce mentioned before, we're allocating $10,000 for Instagram and Facebook ads and affiliate links. And for the third $10,000, we're going to be using that to acquire initial inventory for our company. So this is a three-year operating plan of some goals and objectives for the next 3 years. For the first year, we want to have 2,000 units sold, and that estimated cost of producing one panel is $6.22. We're going to be charging $79.99 for a five-pack, and our main goal at this stage in our business plan is really to establish brand recognition and, like Bryce said before, promote our product through social media to really break into the market. For the next year, we're going to plan to double sales, having 4,000 units sold by the end of the second year, and our estimated cost of producing one panel should be slightly decreased to around $5.50. We're still going to be charging $79.99 for a five-pack at that point in time. We're going to be increasing our marketing budget to $40,000 at this point to really encourage new users to check out our product and look at it and just break into that market a little more. We're going to be continuing outsourcing and manufacturing through JLC PCB. I'm going to talk a little bit about that more later on. And at the end of the second year, we really want to reevaluate our financial standing to determine if we want to continue at this point in time, if the business is viable. And at that point, we can choose to either exit if we some of these goals are not met, or we continue to production to the third year. So that brings our third year of production. We are really going to ramp up production at that point with 20,000 units sold, and hopefully get that estimated cost of reducing one panel down to around $3.80 through economies of scale from a large order quantity. We're going to be introducing new packs of products. So for example, we're charging $19.99 for a single panel. We also do two packs, three packs, and four packs for various prices, just to give the consumer more freedom and how many panels they want. And some consumers may only want one panel or two panels, so that just gives them a little more freedom. We're going to be investing in R&D at this point. Around $50,000 are going to be allocated to that, into producing new products for the older target demographic, and along with just general uses for other things like photography. Like, we're going to be developing ring lights, book lights, and just reading lamps in general. And we're going to have a very aggressive marketing strategy. Oh, yes, please.
A quick question. So this price is $79.99. How did this come about?
So $79.99, we determined that would be the, that would undercut our closest competitor, Govee. They charged a slightly higher price for a similar product. So we feel like we needed to break into this market. We needed to be able to charge less for our product to sell more. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, gotcha. And I guess, have you guys done any like research to like people in your target initial target market, if they'd be willing to pay $79.99 for these panels?
Well, our target demographic is younger individuals, and that's why we're going to be really introducing lower quantities in the future too. The reason for making five packs only available in the beginning stages is we really need to sell a lot of units in the first stages. We can't be selling one unit and shipping that to a consumer in the beginning, at least. And we really need to sell a lot of units in the beginning, basically. I was going to say the aggressive marketing strategy at that point, we're going to be dedicating $200,000 to that, and we're going to be continuing with our social media launch and user advertisements as well. So looking at our three-year income statement, we have a total sales for the first year of around $160,000, with cost of goods sold around $62,000. That's $6.22 multiplied by 2,000 units. This should bring our gross profit to a little under $100,000 for the year. And our total expenses for the year are $24,000, which are composed of our advertising and promotion. We're not going to be paying ourselves for the first year to keep assets within the company. And we're going to be renting a small warehouse for $10,000 for prepaid rent for the year. And we're going to have $4,000 in postage, basically just supplies for shipping the product out of the warehouse. For the next 2 years of production, we're going to have hopefully around $320,000 in sales, which leaves us around $211,000 in gross profit. We're really going to ramp up our advertising and allocate $40,000 to that. increase pretty much double our postage and delivery costs. These are rough estimates for the next couple of years. And that should bring our net income for the year to around $113,000. Moving into the third year, we're planning to really ramp up production at that point, and we're gonna have $1.5 million in sales and with a gross profit of $1.2 million. These are conservative estimates based on the, we believe that we can lower the cost of this product even further. We're gonna be ramping up our advertising and promotion to $200,000. We're gonna be paying ourselves a lot more at this point too, because we want this to be a long-term thing for us. We want this to be our main source of income, and we really wanna dedicate ourselves to this company. And our postage and delivery costs are $50,000 to represent the higher units sold. And we plan to increase our warehouse space just to be able to ship more, so it will cost around $30,000 estimated. For our three-year total, we assume that we're gonna be able to make around $2 million worth in sales with a gross profit of $1.5 million. And this should leave our net income at the end of the third year to around $927,000. So taking a look at our three-year balance sheet, our cash on hand, encompasses the $30,000 of prize money, the $76,000 for crowdfunding, as well as the $73,000 in net income for the year. This brings our total assets and liabilities to around $180,000. You can notice that there are no long-term investments on this balance sheet. And that's because we're gonna be relying solely on our manufacturer, JLC PCB. After some cost-benefit analysis, we determined that making our own product here in the US would not be cost-efficient for us and for the consumer. So really outsourcing that our product from our manufacturer is gonna be the best result for us, basically. As you can see, our net income for the first year is $73,000. That's a healthy amount of cash to have on hand, and that's mainly gonna be reinvested into the next years of production. For the second and third years, we plan to have around $113,000 in net income and a $759,000 in net income for the third year. Moving on to the three-year statement of cash flows, like I said before, our net income was $73,000. Our investing activities for the first year is just our patent, basically. The financing activities are $106,000. It's basically just our the Mayo prize money along with our fundraising campaign. And our closing cash balance for the year should be around $170,000. For the second year, we are not gonna be investing in research and development at that point. We're just gonna try to keep more assets in the company and focus on, you know, building our brand and shipping out more products. So our closing cash balance for the second year would be $283,000. And moving on to our third year, we're gonna be investing $50,000 in research and development, getting a team behind to develop these new products and really push towards those other demographics. And that should leave our ending balance, our closing cash balance, to a little under $1 million for the third year. And now I'm gonna leave it off to Jack to talk about a little about the development process.
Yeah, so now I'll give you guys a little bit more information of how we came to be. So we started a little under a year ago, last spring, with just an idea, and we slowly transformed that into a circuit that we then turned into a board view that you can see here on the left. And then as we progressed, we ended up making our first order from a JLC PCB that you can see in the middle. And then on the right is a little mini video of how we were assembling this and testing it in Armstrong. And that's kind of how we progressed, you know, last semester. So moving forward, this image on the left here just shows our little workstation in Armstrong and how we assembled this product and what we used to test it and debug everything. So we have our soldering iron, our heat station, all of that. And on the right is our latest prototype that we've been working on. And I'll just note that that's the prototype without the diffuser material over the top. So we prepared a little video here just to demonstrate some of the functionality and some of the different colors that we can create. So we'll play that now and I'll walk you guys through it. So as you can see here, I'm just controlling it on my phone. You can see the bright white and some of the different color temperatures. And now I'll go into the red, green, and blue accent lighting that's possible.
And this room is pitch black. This is the only thing that's lighting this entire room.
Yeah, so that's just one panel right there. And you can notice how the colors of the notebooks on the table are changing.
And being able to combine five panels together will make this immensely brighter.
And so it's instant and easy control via Bluetooth on your smartphone. And here's just a little another picture of our expandable design and our prototype for that. And this was our latest prototype. And that's the prototype with just the warm and cool light. And that's just some of our circuitry. And so we can create any color at any intensity. So these pictures here are just to really show you how bright this product can be. So if you're trying to simulate natural light in a bright room, that's necessary. And that's something that none of our competitors like Govee or Nanoleaf can do. So now we'll move forward to a little live demonstration for you guys.
Before you start the demo, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, absolutely.
Where are you on the patent journey in terms of starting to look into what's necessary given you're building this as you go?
So our patent cost was basically just an estimation. We haven't actually looked into acquiring a patent at this point in time. That's partially due to wanting to push production probably at least a couple years from now. We wouldn't want to take this right to market after we get out of school. Just due to the global supply chain issues and chip shortages, we think the best possibility of success for this specific business is if we wait for those issues to either resolve themselves or reevaluate later in time.
And so now we'll give you guys a little demonstration. So first we'll just show how we can go from dim light to super bright. So we don't want to blind you here because so don't look directly at it. So that's our full output, just one panel. So you can see how that would be useful in a very bright space, or if you're trying to simulate natural light. And now I can show you, I'm controlling this all from my phone, so I can pick, add a little green in there, change the color temperature a little bit, or I can turn off the white lights completely and create some of those dramatic effects that we were showing before. So that might be useful to a digital creator or somebody in photography.
So we can go through a whole array of different colors here. So yeah, any other questions? All right, thank you everyone for coming out here today. We appreciate
it. Thank you very
much.
So at this particular point, the judges will convene to another room and they will do their deliberations and make their decision. For the people on Zoom, it is not over. If you can just hang out there for a bit, and when the judges return, we will get the announcement of the order of the winners. And so if you can just hang on, kind of just relax, or if you just want to walk out and stretch your legs or whatever. While the judges go out, Stephanie's standing at the top to tell you where to go. I see here, I think, a lot of parents. And so could you raise your hand if you're a parent? So right here, can you tell us who your son is and which group? Witz Financial. Another group of parents? Please. AlpineAid. Very nice. Illuminate. Anybody else? Family? Very nice. So congratulations to all of you. You must be exceedingly proud of them. Good for you. This is really exceptionally good. Now, what about friends? Friends of AlpineAid. Round of applause. No, huh? Maybe on Zoom. Witz Financial, I heard a lot of applause for them. And then Illuminate. Do you have any questions or anything at all about how the competition runs or anything you'd like to know? No? You just want to hang? Okay. These students are so incredible, are they not? It's just, you know, we went from a large mechanical type project to a total service app type thing to then electronic. It's just, it is truly amazing. 21, 22 years old. Presenting like corporate professionals. It's just, it's very professional. TCNJ.
Thank you.
So just to let you know, we are really ready to reconvene. The teams can come down and sit here, and then the judges will be down in just a moment. So while we're waiting, this is very exciting for our campus community. So we have deans here. This is Steve O'Brien, the interim dean of engineering, who's heading up the stairs. Here to support his students, Suzanne McCotter is here. She is from the School of Education. And our Provost and Vice President of Academic Affairs, Jeff Osborne. We have a finance professor here, Dr. Sung-Hee Choi, who is the chair of the department. Just want to say, I know it's going to get very busy in a couple of minutes. Thank you all for coming. We really appreciate it. I understand there were quite a few people on Zoom, so thanks too for you for watching and participating with our students who rely on you too for your support. Like the Academy Awards or something. But you know, just kind of keep it casual. We were discussing how professional you all are in seeing the power of your class. You are presenting people, you are putting the dress, your manner is excellent, your speak, your way everything is so attractive to the students. You are also going on to very much your career. Thank you.
This is good right here. So it's great to see people in person. The judges and I have been doing this virtually for the last 2 years, so I'm pretty excited to be here. And we do want to thank Dr. Mayo for his continued support of the competition, and Professor Szabo for continuing to allow us to increase the prize money. Obviously, Dean Jervis and her staff have been fantastic in managing the process and keeping this moving forward. So we are very excited to be here, and it does not feel like work to us. We absolutely are impressed by the unique ideas that the students have presented for services and products. And each team did incorporate feedback that we provided during the semifinalist round. So appreciate that very much. We know it was work for you to do that. The bar just continues to rise. Every year that we judge, the bar continues to rise. And we, as judges, are all alum of the College of New Jersey and very excited that the quality of our students, their commitment, their enthusiasm is just amazing to see. So thank you again for all participating and all the hard work you did. So now we get down to the winners. So we're going to start with number three. And again, everyone did a fantastic job. Difficult decision. But the third place winners are eLuminate. We love the idea. You know I want to buy it. So when you hit my age bracket, let me know. I'll be there. Our second place winner is Alpine. And our first place winners goes to Witz. Congratulations. Appreciate everything you did. Thank you very much for coming this evening. We'll end this now at this particular time. You can congratulate all of the winners out in the lobby, and there is, you know, some snacks and treats out there, so please help yourself. And congratulations again to all of you. Thank you.
tell people that Liberty Mutual customizes car.
Groove, let the madness in the music get to you, like they so